Thank you very much. It's my pleasure to be here with you to have a tri-summit, more or less on three issues which have a huge convergence. It is also my good fortune that we have here in our midst today some eminent hands-on people. Dr. Prasanna Kumarji, the CMD NLC, Navy Lignite, G.S. Rawat, Deputy MD of NEPAD, Dr. Popli, Dr. V.K. Garg, Mr. B.C. Bora, a very distinguished senior colleague, Dr. Anil Garg and Mrs. Garg. The meeting or tri-summit that we have today, it's become, I think, fashionable to be synergetic, right from the armed forces where we have a tri-forces command and everything is now tri. And of course, these days, the days of Remembrance Day of Lord Shiva, he also holds a trident. So it only symbolizes a unity of purpose. And that no single force or technology is there which is supreme. It's a combination of these practices. We have the World Renewable Energy Congress, the World Summit, Water Summit, and also the Waste to Wealth. Because all these activities ultimately generate a waste also, which we think sometimes is waste, but actually is wealth. If we have the capability to recognize its worth and also ensure that we put it to a useful purpose. Because anything that exists on this planet has a purpose. Unless it is toxic, if it is highly toxic, it has to be detoxed and kept for safe storage. Of course, there are some elements or compounds in the nuclear sector which we've not yet found the technology for reprocessing, or it is too expensive, so we keep them in safe storage. Otherwise, for a circular economy, we first thing is the realization that yes, these are all products of nature and have to be resourced together, synthesized back to a use. I think the themes are a logical outcome of a circular economy and a sustainable economy and a sustainable civilization. That is, I think, the virtual theme of this whole meet, two-day meet, that by itself, nothing is standalone. We have to realize that to be sustainable, it has to be circular and has to be brought back into some kind of use. Let's say that how many millennia it has taken for us to realize that a civilization which is sustainable can only come out of a circular economy. The Industrial Revolution made us forget the basics of any form of human civilization and development. The results are there for all of us to see. The high levels of carbon deposits, the vitiating of the environment. Now, who's done it? It's been mindless exploitation. And as the old song went when I was a young man, one-way ticket to the moon. So it's a one-way ticket to destruction. If you don't realize that it's a circular phenomena, whether it is agriculture, or it is transport, or it is employment, or it is habitat. This realization of sustainability and the need to leave, I should say, a habitat, and in a larger sense, the planet, more livable or as livable as you inherited it, is the prime purpose of any sustainable development or the core of any activity. Each one of us has been through a series of government responsibilities or commercial responsibilities. And it is the effort that, yes, we do not leave that organization or that office in a state of destruction or in a situation that could pull harmful to the environment in which it is working. That basic realization has to come in the sense of economy. It's a bit philosophical, what I'm trying to attempt. It's a realization that you are part of a whole process of life, evolution, completing your purpose, moving on to the next, and leaving it a better place for those who are going to follow you. It may be opposed to the thinking of the last two or three millennia particularly, where I think development turned into a very selfish and a self-making exercise, not realizing that all this mound of pollution or waste that we are creating without thinking of its ultimate use or better use or recycling, we're going to leave this planet unlivable for future generations. Because our own lifespan on an average is not going to be exceeding about 70 years or 80 years. What happens after that? And that's a tiny speck in the whole life of this planet, what to talk of universe. So when we talk of sustenance, I would think in terms of what is the purpose of life. It is to find energy for our needs, water for our subsistence, food for our subsistence, wealth for our subsistence, and for rearing a family around you, and in the whole process, to be able to also create some gainful employment for those around us. There are civilizations within civilizations, which we think are much lesser civilizations. Take the ants, the bees. They all, I'm talking of those who live in colonies in reasonably large numbers. They have duties divided. They work by a cycle of nature. They work in sync with nature. So all the themes that you have today are basically living in harmony with nature. The bees know when to visit the flowers, what to make out of them, and how to live together. The ants, whom we think don't have a brain, they know when it is going to rain, and how much they should store, and how they should store, and where they should store. But we, much larger creatures, we seem to have forgotten these basics. We think that we can hoard individually, we can blow up resources individually, not realizing that ultimately all of us have to live on this planet. I remember almost 15 years ago, when the Bali summits and these were going on, a very senior head of state from one of the developed countries of the world at a dinner asked me, "So what are you doing about it? You must stop your consumption." I said, "What is our per capita consumption? What is yours? Please think of that. If you say it's one planet, we've got to share this responsibility equally." He said, "Oh, don't worry about us. Think of yourselves. We could be living on planet Venus." My reply to him was that, "Sorry, we're already living on Mars in this part of the world. Life is extremely tough and gruesome. So if you're talking of a livable planet, think of every citizen having an equal right to exist, and that is the basis of any democracy or a democratic institution. That the power of each voter is as strong or as weak as the power of the president of that country or the prime minister of that country." So that realization in a global sense, that realization in a national sense, a state sense, a locality, or a habitat has to pervade our thinking. These, in my view, are the guiding principles, thoughts. We've had very learned discourses from our colleagues, and you will continue to have them for the next 2 days. What is ultimately a democracy that we all are living in and striving for? The welfare of the larger populace. Periodic tenures and periodic assessments. That's what at least the majority of us who are sitting on this side, we go through. We have our tenures, we have our assessments, and so do our elected leaders. And where we do not have that assessment, they don't fill those annual ACR proforma, as you and I do in various organized employments. But they have to give an account, if not every day, at the end of 5 years. And the people know it, whether educated or uneducated, that who has performed, who has not performed, who has performed for his own good, and who has performed for public good. That is the law of nature. That those who perform for society as a whole have a right to further existence, and those who've forgotten that basic charter must go. Yes, they come back also, once there is a realization, and they promise to do so again. Now, this is when we are talking of resources. We have our periods of, I should say, memory setbacks when we are thinking of burning the resources of this planet mindlessly, not realizing that a future generation, my own flesh and blood, have to live on this planet also. And maybe in my own lifetime, we've all seen it. Those of us who've been living in metros, a person like me was born in Delhi, brought up in Delhi, worked mostly in Delhi or around Delhi. And I see the deterioration in the quality of life. Yes, we have a lot of swanky vehicles moving around, air-conditioned buildings around. But the moment you step out, it's a lot more worse than it was when I was a school kid. That is the kind of subject that we are thinking about today. And when we talk of technologies, we talk of resources, it is all that basic thing that we have forgotten somewhere. We had our senior colleague from NABARD telling us all that was happening on the ground and ought to happen on the ground for agriculture. Mr. Rawat has worked in that area. He's grown up from those areas. He can smell the soil. And unless each one of you can smell the soil and know what it means to serve the soil, we will not have that commitment. And that is the lesson, I think, which events like this have to give us, that what is our national priority? Yes, any economy, any organization has to move in tandem with the resources, its commerce, its future aspirations to grow. The state imposes, how does it gain resources it garners through taxation, your capacity to pay or contribute to national priorities. Somewhere in all this, there is a unified thinking, an objective, a goal, and a periodic assessment of what you have done. And I think somewhere where modern civilization is tripped, it is that concept of a village economy which people like Mahatma Gandhi had advocated. What was a village economy? It was a self-sustaining economy. You knew each other's pains. You lived through that. You didn't live in air-conditioned ivory towers far remote from the experiences of your fellow inhabitants or citizens of that place. It's that realization that has to come back to us. It's as simple as that. We can put it in any form. Now, what has employment? I think employment again has to be linked to your resources that you have, by and large. Otherwise, you keep migrating to other countries, like many of our youths. My generation started doing that. But we chose to stay back. We knew there was so much to do in this country. And at the end of the day, we may have earned less material assets than them. But I think that sense of satisfaction, that sense of having given back to society what you took from them, is a great feeling which I think each one of us has to recognize. What do we have to watch in our policies? What are our needs? Do we match them with resources? Do we match them with employment? Do we match them with sustainability? Mr. Popley has worked extensively in the renewable energy sector. I would keep arguing, even post-retirement, with the ministers in charge of this sector, that please do not implement a program for the benefit of a neighboring country. Develop your own manufacturing capacity, then launch your program. Find employment avenues for your own youth and technologists, and then move accordingly. What are we doing? We are just making somebody else wealthy, and at the end of the day, increasing the burden on us. Yes, that is the right way to go. That is the future. We all know it. We cannot live in the fossil environment forever. I worked in the fossil sector. I worked in the nuclear sector. And I've also worked in the hydro sector. So I know the advantages of each and the limitations of each. But at the end of all this, there is something that we have to keep track of, and that was an area that was extremely dear to me, and that was the area of energy efficiency. In fact, I had the privilege of pushing the Bureau of Energy Efficiency as a joint secretary, the legislation. Your star marking of consumer products. Consumer has a right to know. Ultimately, we've got to consume as little as possible and get the maximum work out of it. That is, I think, a lesson in sustainability. Life is full of paradoxes. It's not going to equalize, at least not in my lifetime. They will be rich, they will be poor. There are regions in the same country like ours, extreme heat, extreme cold. Their weathers, their wet regions, their dry regions. One side, you have hydrogen as the touted source, the lightest of elements. The other side, you have uranium, one of the heaviest. They all have to coexist for our purpose. There's peak energy, there's baseload energy. You've got to find a balance as a system operator between the two. It's part of our very existence. Sorry for sounding so basic. Even our blood pressure has two readings, the systolic and the diastolic. It's part of life. So bring us back to a circular economy or a circular civilization, that the buck gets back to us sometime. How long can we point it? At the end of the day, I think the theme of this conference virtually is that we have to respect nature. We have to respect its finite resources. We have to realize that there is a technology which is relevant to a particular region, to a particular climate, and to a particular people at a particular genetic strain of people. And that is the environment and the technology that we have to adopt. And wisdom lies in not aping somebody else, but finding the best way to do it yourself. Yes, if you think you can beat him and become greater than him, please do so. But carrying your neighborhood with you and not alone. It is that selfish instinct which starts from a very cellular person within a family to a community, ultimately to an organization or to a nation. In the course of this two-day event, we have the fortune of meeting at the time when the renewable energy sector has seen a very major initiative by the government, and that is the PM Surya Ghar Muft Bijli Yojana, which I think is going to provide a huge opportunity for using your natural resources, for providing employment, and for trying to protect the environment. The goals are ambitious, but I think totally achievable, given the kind of resources that this country has. The outlay of 75,000 crores for an economy like ours, I think, is something that is totally doable. I was just going through some statistics, and if I'm not wrong, in the clean energy sector, new investments have been 8.5 lakh crores between 2014 and 19. and the renewable energy investment that we're looking at between 24 and 30 in 6 year span is rupees 30.5 lakh crores. And it's not much. When you see the size of transactions of commercial takeovers that are being talked about, it's only, and if we must realize this mission, be a part of it, and part of it with feeling, conviction, and also a resolve that it has to be done within a certain time frame. Whether it is hydrogen or it is renewable energy, all these are for the benefit of mankind, without forgetting that there is no life without water. A human being eats to generate energy. He has cells to store energy. And so does the planet and its activities need all this for any form of sustainable living. As they say in Hindi, Der Aaye Durust Aaye, it's high time that we understand the laws of nature, respect them, and also in all humility, understand that we have a limited purpose in life, a limited lifespan. We cannot take anything away with us. We have to go the way we came, from dust into dust. Thank you very much.